This morning I'm going to be singing Your Grace Still Amazes Me.
Thank you. Thank you, Wayne. His grace amazes me too. How about you? How thankful we ought to be for God's amazing grace, God's riches at Christ's expense. I'm so thankful that God loves us here today and that He longs to meet each and every need that's represented in our lives. As we consider launching this new program, and as we consider welcoming all of our new friends in the life of our church, there are some key words that I hope you and I will remember. We were talking this morning out in the narthex about some things that we might consider negative, and that's taxes, insurance, and all the things that you and I are obligated to do while we're living in this world. And I told Brother Jerry, I said, you know, I'm going to have to quit talking about this and get more positive attitude for the sermon. There are key words that you and I need to remember if we're going to progress as a congregation and if we're going to meet the needs that are in our lives and the lives of other people. Turn with me to Philippians chapter 4. And I want us to read beginning at verse 9. If you'd like to stand for the reading of the word, you're invited to. Philippians chapter 4, reading verse 9 through 13. Those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do. And the God of peace shall be with you. But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care of me hath flourished again, wherein you were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I've learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased and I know how to abound. Everywhere in all things I'm instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. And then verse 13 says, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. You may be seated. What a powerful statement the Apostle Paul makes to the church at Philippi, and how these words should be the key words of each and every congregation that meets together in the name of God. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Aren't you glad for that promise? I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. This new program we're starting, we can do it. Amen? The outreach of this church is going to be successful because we can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth us. Let us look to the Lord in a word of prayer this morning. Father, we're so thankful for this wonderful promise recorded in the Word of God through the testimony of the Apostle Paul. Oh God, how it encourages us to know that the things we think impossible are possible when we rely on Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. We can do all things through Him, because He is the one who will strengthen us. He is the one who's our source of power and wisdom and strength. How we praise You, God, this morning, that we're going to be victorious because we're looking to the one who cried out, "It is finished. It's completed." All things are marked with an exclamation mark of victory. how we thank you this morning, dear God, that we're a part of his wonderful family, assured of victory as we go in his name and trust in his power. We simply ask your blessing upon the message you've laid upon our heart, that every one of us will hear that message, respond to that message, receive it into our hearts and lives, that we can leave here with a positive spirit, excited about what Jesus Christ is going to do through this congregation. We ask these favors in Jesus' precious name. Amen. We received a picture yesterday while we were on the road. And it happened to be in a huge pumpkin patch. And the pumpkins were enormous. And what made that pumpkin patch so beautiful to Sister Abner and I, right smack dab between three or four of the largest pumpkins, our little three-month-old grandson Luke in his overalls and hat and boots lay. Of course, we thought it was wonderful. And I thought how proud Jonathan and Kim are of their new little boy, and how proud we are. And I remembered how Maria and I were so anxious to hear the first words from our children. That's a big time in the life of the family, amen. I told her it was going to be Dada, she said Mama. And then the answer soon came. But the first words of our children are so important to us. And I know some people put a lot of weight in the last words that people speak. And some people make it a hobby to go to the cemeteries and read the epitaphs of men and women who've gone on to meet their reward. One that I read one time was very interesting. It says, "Here lies one who did his best. He hopes it will pass the judgment test." Here lies one who did his best. He hopes it will pass the judgment test. Well, it's an interesting epitaph, but his theology is not quite right. We strive to do our best, but the eternal consequence of that rests not on how much we've done or how good we've been. It rests upon our relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen? Jesus gives the victory. And when you and I confess that we've sinned and come short of the glory of God and invite Jesus Christ into our heart and life and strive to do the very best that we can do, trusting in him, our eternal destiny is sure. Amen? Amen. I remember preparing a series of sermons on the seven last words of Jesus Christ on the cross. Some of you may have remembered that. It was a long, long time ago. But it was so interesting to dive into the last words that Jesus shared from the cross of Calvary. Someone said to me the other day, "Brother Abner, do you know what the last words of the church are?" I said, "No." He said to me, "We never did it that way before." The seven last words of the church are, "We never did it that way before." If the church does not embrace change, we are nearing death. Amen? It's amen whether you amen it or not. If we don't embrace change, then certainly we're nearing death. Change is inevitable in the world in which we live. Does the message change? Of course it does. Man is saved through the preaching of the Word of God. But there are changes that take place. If those are the seven last words of the church, I want to share with you what should be the key words of the church for victory. And they're found in our text. I can do all things through Christ. I can do all things through Christ. These are the words of our text. They're a good summary statement of the Apostle Paul's life. Amid all the shipwrecks, amid all the beatings, amid all the stonings, amid all the years of imprisonment, the Apostle Paul said, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. They certainly should be the words on which we as a church base our life and our ministry. We should be excited about new things and the possibility to reach into our community that others may come to know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Please note, if you will, that these words of the church are positive. Paul said, I can. And it's amazing to me when you consider where Paul was. He was in prison. He was in bondage, awaiting possible martyrdom for the cause of Jesus Christ. And yet he says, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. He knew mankind did not hold his destiny in their hands. We read of the other apostles in Luke who said, whom shall we fear? Those of you that can kill our bodies or the Lord that controls the destiny of our souls? So Paul was excited even in prison because he knew that if God wanted him here on this earth, he was going to continue to accomplish the building of the kingdom of God. He also knew that to be absent from this body was to be present with the Lord. He could not lose, praise God. He was on the winning side. I've had people say to me, Brother Abshire, I just can't control my temper. You ever had anyone tell you that? I'm sorry, I cannot. I've tried and tried. I cannot control my temper. Paul didn't say he could do all things. He didn't say he could do all things, did he? He said, I could do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. My friend, even our tempers can be brought into harness when we submit to the Holy Spirit within us. There's nothing of our nature that cannot be controlled through the power of the Holy Spirit. Our tongues can be controlled. It says, no man can tame the tongue, but it goes on to say, these things ought not to be. Why? Because now under the new covenant, we have the Holy Spirit within us to control the tongue, the unruly member of the body. Some people say, I can't cope with my thoughts. I'm just constantly thinking about bad things. My mama used to tell me, Wayne, you can't keep the birds from flying over your head, but you can keep them from building a nest in your hair. Amen? We're to bring every thought into subjection to Jesus Christ. We can do it through Jesus Christ. That's the victory of our salvation. Had a person tell me the other day, I can't stand my boss or my job. It's my secretary. No. I'm just, it wasn't treason. Can't stand my boss or my job. My friend, we can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth us. If we begin to pray for the individual, begin to hold them up to the Lord and realize that God can make something beautiful of their lives. Many people say, I can't teach Sunday school. or I can't pray in public. You'd be amazed when you surrender to the Holy Spirit what you're able to do. How God can take our loaves and fishes and multiply them to feed the multitudes. And I can't tell you the number of people who've told me, I just cannot witness, Brother Absher. There's no way I can share with other people. I just don't have a command of the Scripture. I can't answer all the theological questions. Ron Howland told me when I was just a young pastor training in Bible college years ago in Houston, Texas, he said, Wayne, if someone asks you a question you don't know, just tell them, I don't know the answer to that question, but I'm a Christian, so you must not have to know the answer to get saved. And after we deal with the matter of whether or not you know Jesus Christ, your personal Savior, we'll go ask some theologian. And he'll give us the answer to your question. I thought that's a pretty good answer. You don't have to know the answer to be a Christian. If you did, you wouldn't be a Christian. So get back. Don't let the devil sidetrack you. We can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth us. One of the greatest arguments for Christianity is the argument of apologetics. People sharing their own testimony. People sharing what Jesus Christ has done for them. No one can put down or denounce what the Lord's done for you. It's a reality in your life. Let others know about it. We can do all things through Christ. Others say, Brother Absher, I can't live the Christian life. And I love to respond by saying, I know. I can't either. In my own strength. But when I rely upon the salvation of Jesus Christ, His grace given me freely, His mercy given me freely, His forgiveness given me freely, when I rely on His advocacy at the right hand of God, meaning if I ever fail, I can ask His forgiveness and He cleanses me of that transgression and I get up and keep going for Him. When I rely on His Holy Spirit, when I rely that in every temptation He makes escape, wow, that changes the whole picture. I can do it because Christ has covered every base all the way home. Amen. Instead of negatives and saying, I can't do it, let's consider the positive. We can do it through Christ. As a church, we should not major on what we don't have in ways of budgets or buildings, but what we should focus on is what we do have in the way of people and programs and possibilities. I'm excited about Rock Creek Church of God and what she has to give in this community. Secondly, key words of the church found in our text suggest a pattern for us to follow. Paul said, I can do all things. Against the tide of public opinion or the endorsement of right, quote unquote, people, Paul led the then known world to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Oh, my friends, Paul began to do things because he believed that Jesus would make the difference. I believe this morning every one of us should begin to do something. Don't be overwhelmed about how much there is to do. Yes, our nation is in moral bankruptcy and financial bankruptcy. Yes, the church in many quarters is lukewarm and indifferent and complacent. Only half of Christians registered to vote this coming election, as important as it is. My friends, listen. We have a responsibility as children of God to realize that regardless of all the things that we face, all the foes, all the arguments that Satan would give us, we can do something for the Lord. How many of you believe that? We can do something for the Lord. Do you believe it? We can do something for the Lord. As we start on this program, I want you to note the Apostle Paul's pattern. He went to one place. He attempted to do one thing. And then he moved on to the next place. We can take one person. We can take one family at a time. And concentrate upon them and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're not asked to do it all at once. We're asked to do something. Isn't it amazing that Jesus committed world evangelization to 12 men? He went back to be with the Father and committed world evangelization to 12 men. Now finally, these key words of the church affirm a presence, and that's what makes it possible. How is any of this done? Paul said, I can do all things through Christ. The secret of our power is Christ working through us that makes possible for us victorious Christian living. It makes possible effective Christian ministry. It's Christ in us, the hope of glory. I read a story one time of a French farmer who visited his church for an hour every morning before going to his fields. And then coming home from the fields, he visited church for another hour at the close of the day. Someone observed that for a lengthy period of time, and they asked the old farmer, he says, what do you do in those 2 hours every day? First hour in the morning, you're in the church. Second hour, at the close of the day, you're in the church. What do you do? And the farmer's response was this, I simply look at Christ and allow him to look at me. I look at Christ and allow him to look at me. Certainly that's what the Bible challenges us to do. In chapter 12 of the book of Hebrews, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. And then it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Verse 3 is so captivating. For consider him, the Greek says, make an analogy between your commitment and his commitment. Consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. Rock Creek Church of God, if we will spend time each day looking at Christ and allowing him to look into our hearts and lives, we can do it. There's no limit to what we can accomplish as a congregation. We're going to see souls saved and bodies healed and the unity of the body of faith. We're going to see exciting days in our future as we look to Christ and allow him to look into our lives and make of us what he wants us to be. This is our source of power. We can only do it through Jesus Christ, our Lord. In closing this morning, is there anything that you've written off as something that can't be done in your life? Anything? Maybe you're not a Christian. You say, "Preacher, I can't live the life." Have you written it off as something you cannot do? Have you considered that you can do it through Christ? Is there any habit that you want broken in your life and you say, "Preacher, I've tried, I can't do it"? Have you considered that Christ can do it working with you? Is there any ministry that you've written off and you say, "I can't do it," but God says, "Consider my son Jesus and what he's made available to you. You can do it through him." Will we be willing to give Jesus a chance in our life this morning? I'm convinced if we will, we can be victorious through him. Let's stand together as we look to him in a word of prayer, shall we? Our song leader will come and lead us in a time of invitation. Let us pray. Father, we're so thankful this morning that you've made all the difference in our lives. We could not do what we do apart from you, O Lord. And when we try to do it in our own strength, we fail miserably. But when we lean on the power and strength and grace and mercy and forgiveness of Almighty God, we always see victory. God bless the people that are assembled here. You know the needs of their life. May they not leave hindered. May they not leave burdened down with the cares of life. May they not leave, O God, without the victory that you bought and paid for them. May they come and say, "It's not my brother, it's not my sister, but it's me, O Lord, that stands in the need of prayer." We pray in Christ's name. Amen.